And I have the privilege, Chris, of having seen Myquan Williams since he was an amateur. He's a five-time national champion, turned pro at only 17 years old, and he's a real prospect, and I think it's a real treat we're going to get to see him.
Cool.
Well, you know which corner has the crowd based on Myquan Williams' reception.
Dan's favorite, and that's a lot of people coming up from Connecticut to see him. Which
to the north shore of Massachusetts,
yeah, really
that's
impressive.
Not an easy drive.
And Sowau Corral, very interesting fighter. For a period of time, he was sort of the go-to journeyman for everyone in the 147-pound division. He's fought numerous world champions in his career. He's kind of on the tail end of that now, and some people saying maybe he's not bringing anything to the table. But, you know, he's always a durable guy, and his experience is incredible. I mean, Sean, I mean, everybody. I mean, Victor Ortiz. Jose Cito Lopez, Saddam Ali. I mean, he's been in there with multiple world champions. So he's at a point where a prospect like Myquan gets to test where he's at against Sowau Corral.
Yeah, and that experience is that experience, even if he is at the tail end of his career and his prime and whatnot. That type of experience speaks for itself. It's going to take a lot for him to see something he hasn't seen before.
100%.
One thing I'm noticing right off the bat, guys, look at the speed of Myquan's jab, though. That's one thing I just love, is how fast his jab is. But this man is noticeably physically bigger than Myquan. I think Myquan's speed is going to have that under wraps very shortly here, but I just watch how sharp Myquan is, though, guys.
Yeah, his jab is beautiful. He's bringing it down to the body right away, which is always smart against a taller guy, and really fast, and even snuck in that little overhand right up top. So I think speed's really going to be the difference here ultimately.
And that's Myquan's game, is speed. He has power, but his speed is really, I think, what separates. And his accuracy and his speed, I think, is what separates him.
Even there has a beautiful three-punch combination where most guys probably just would have thrown two punches.
Williams officially listed at 5'6", Corral at 5'9.5".
Yeah, which, and 5'6" is actually pretty short for the welterweight division.
Welterweight division. You know? I think Myquan is, you know, I know his coach Paul. I think the plan for Myquan is for him to really, truly more campaign at 140. I could be wrong.
Okay.
Something might have changed. But for the most part, Myquan is a 140-pounder, to my knowledge, unless something's changed.
Gotcha.
I think they said he weighed about 144 pounds tonight.
Okay.
Nice fainting by Myquan.
Yeah, there was definitely some weight issues with a few of the fighters yesterday at weigh-in, so I think some contracts had to be changed. So I think several fighters.
Beautiful left hook by Williams. He's got him in trouble. Look at that hand speed.
Oh, he's catching him with the hooks.
And that's something he does very well. I remember watching him as an amateur. He actually beat another guy that was a pro prospect at one point, Anthony Marcella, and he was able to whistle off that left hook just so fast. Mm. It was back in the Golden Gloves.
Yeah, really impressive.
About 2 years before he turned pro. Yeah, the left hand moves exceptionally fast. Both of his hands do, but especially that left hand.
But you made a really good point, Corral. He's seen everything. He's seen power. He's seen speed. He's seen some of the best fighters in the world. And he usually does rounds. He's not a guy that gets out of there in one or two. Middle of the fight when he starts to get caught. But, you know, very impressive first round from Myquan to touch Sowau Corral like he is.
Myquan is a former teammate of Matt Rimillard, who was also trained by Paul Chacon. And one thing I can assure you, being teammates with Matt and being trained by Paul, is Williams is a hell of a body puncher. So let's see if he warms that up tonight.
Yeah. And Corral looks a little soft to the body. He doesn't have the physique that he was sporting even up to 3 years ago. So I'm sure some body work's going to start to come into play after he talks to his trainer.
Yeah, actually, a guy that he came up with that I just mentioned, Matt Remillard, he's one of my favorite body punchers in boxing, period.
Oh,
he's
wow.
that good of a body puncher. Oh. Yeah.
Hey, Chris, to your point, Coral has 42 professional bouts, 209 rounds.
Oh, that's stunning. And if you look at the list of some of the gentlemen he stepped in the ring with, you got names like, the list is endless, from prospects like Rashidi Ellis and Eddie Gomez.
Former Lynn Mass contender,
yeah,
Rashidi
Alexander,
Ellis.
Vesputin, former world champion. Victor Ortiz, former world champion. Josecito Lopez has challenged for the world title, I believe, three times. Saddam Ali, former world champion. I mean, it's a who's who of the welterweight division in the past decade.
Francisco Medel in a WBC Fika Box welter title.
Yeah, I mean, he has been there and done it. He's seen it all. So it's a nice opponent for Myquan Williams as well, because he's going to be tested a bit.
Yeah, my understanding, guys, is it was supposed to be another opponent, but that fell out about a week ago.
Okay.
So
He took this on a last-minute fight, Corral.
Yes.
But look at that. I mean, he's not afraid to go in there with the prospect and try and put him on the ropes and throw a combination.
And his hand speed was pretty impressive there, too. It surprised me. I'd like to see him jabbing more, being the longer man, even if he's not the faster man. Look at that. I just love the speed of Mike Williams' left hand.
Yes.
That was a balance.
You know, one thing I noticed in Danny's fight is that emblem on the middle of the canvas is pretty out of control.
He slipped twice on it.
Yeah,
I saw that.
It's massive, and it's more of a vinyl thing. You know, they have the little small ones in spots, but when you have a huge circular one like that, I think we're going to see a couple more slips tonight.
It's funny, Chris. I said that everybody fighting moving forward from Robles' fight should pay attention to that.
Yeah, absolutely. It's exchanging like that, trying to plant down and throw a shot's really, really difficult.
And just a little bit of moisture gets on it, and the whole thing turns into a little ice skating rink.
Great moment though when the ref went down and on his hands and knees, and the crowd and fighters gave him a standing ovation. You know, you gotta love that. That's the fun stuff you see at club shows. Mm. Oh, look at Corral putting a nice combination together.
Yes.
Williams fighting for just the third time out of his home arena, Foxwoods Resort Casino.
Yeah, that is his home base by all means. And if you're from Connecticut, why not?
Why not? Right. Yeah. And let's just keep in mind, guys, that he is a five-time national champion as an amateur, so he's well-traveled.
Yeah, and that's the type of fighter that can attract management like Jackie Callan out of the gate and
exactly.
Put him in a place for a major opportunity and clearly keeping him busy, you know.
Round two, more competitive and more exciting, though, guys.
Yeah. Coral throwing a little bit more in this round.
Yeah.
I'm just curious to see, guys. I want you to see that, because I'm almost positive that Williams is a very good body puncher, and I think it's just a matter of time until he starts doing it, and I think you guys will be even more impressed than you are.
Corral getting a little warning.
He's here to fight, though.
Yeah. You got to love it. I mean, to be that well-traveled, I mean, he's been on major stages before. I mean, he's been main event national television. He's been on several of the larger promoters' cards in arenas. So to see him tonight at Melrose Memorial Hall giving it hell is actually, it's a treat if you're a boxing fan.
Absolutely. You know? And to see a veteran, a worldly veteran like that fight a true prospect in Williams, it's just a treat to boxing fans, period.
Yeah. And it's nice to see him fight a prospect that's not under the banner of one of the major promoters, if you will.
Right.
Because what's nice about that is, you know, he's getting experience that some guys don't. They don't get to fight in ball shows.
Yep.
When you get to the point where you have a record like his, you find yourself in the undercard of big events. And this is real. You know?
Yes.
You know, this is where a lot of those wars happen, you know. Speaking of, this is just a fantastic venue for boxing. I've had the pleasure of being here before. I adore this venue.
I love Melrose Memorial Hall. It's one of my favorite Massachusetts venues. I'd say top three favorite Massachusetts venues. The Roxy, or down to called the Royale, is up there. And I love House of Blues in Boston as well.
Of course.
Fun place to be. But I'd put this in my top three.
Oh, yes.
Boston boxing knows how to get these venues with that awesome character. This is an old classical building.
Yeah. This basically, if you're going to film a movie about boxing and it's a period piece, I don't care where you're located, you have to come to Melrose, Massachusetts and do it in Memorial Hall.
Well said, Chris. This would be the first place I would say to do a, you know, documenting a fighter's career and his rise up, this is where I would have those fights on the way up to the top.
Incredible, yeah.
If I were a director.
Absolutely.
Round three, guys, coming up here with Williams and Corral. Yeah, the one thing that just strikes me, guys, is that, you know, how big Corral physically looks. Most of his fights been at welterweight,
yes,
or even junior middleweight?
Primarily welterweight.
Is there a cut?
Yeah. He's actually put on a little bit of weight since the last time I saw him. I think he's actually been down to 140 as well.
Okay, so roughly, relative, you know, frames can be funny, so it sounds like he's probably around the same size guy. Because that's what Williams, to my knowledge, I'll check with his coach after the fight, but
what
I'm
a
pretty
beautiful,
sure he's a
beautiful
natural 140
counter hook
pounder.
There.
His left hand moves just so fast. His right moves exceptionally fast, too, but it's his left hand that really catches my eye, his jab and his hook.
I think that hook's going to have some success for Myquan, because I've actually, if I remember correctly, I believe he was stopped by both Victor Ortiz and
Williams. They're pointing out just what you were saying, Chris, that the logo on the the ring apron is wet. They have a towel ready in the Williams corner.
The ref's getting ready to work again.
Leo's asking for it.
This is where you would cue the Benny Hill theme song.
Of course, that the logo of the Massachusetts State Police boxing team.
Is that what that is? Okay.
And it's a nice logo. It's just a little bit of a troublesome logo.
Yeah, we don't want to insult anyone. The logo itself is a thing of beauty.
Especially the Massachusetts State Police boxing team.
And Leo Grissel, who's there, his job once upon a time was state. He was a Massachusetts State Police officer.
Which is maybe why he's keeping such good care of such a wonderful canvas.
See, that's what you guys saw there, though, the way Williams sharp was just was so sharp with that right hand. That's what he is. He's a sharpshooter. His accuracy, I'd say, is even more impressive than the speed.
Yeah. He's getting some good work from Sal Corral, though. This is absolutely the type of opponent that a prospect wants to be in, where he's going to get some resistance.
Absolutely. Yeah, he'll come out of this a better fighter. And it's not over yet. He's still got a live man in front of him.
But that's it's hard to have defense when you're in there with a guy whose hands are that fast.
Because
that split second that glove's not back at that chin, Myquan's capitalizing on it.
And I mentioned his body attack. One thing he is doing well, I'm eventually looking forward to seeing the right hand and especially the left hook start landing to the body for Williams. But if you guys have noticed, he speared that jab in there well a few times already.
And it's really interesting because he's in there with a taller guy. If you notice, he's not quite slipping Corral's jab. He's actually rolling under it. He's short enough where he's just dipping under the jab. Whereas most guys are forced to, you know, throw that slip to the side.
Looks like Williams is starting to put his foot on the gas and inch his way just physically closer to Corral.
But I think he's actually maybe getting a little more resistance than maybe he even expected. He's handling it incredibly well, but there were some people that thought this could potentially be a quick night. And that's not Sorrell Corral's plan this evening.
Often when you hear they had somebody else in place and then that they that there's a last-minute fill-in within a week, that can be expected,
but that's not a solid last-minute replacement. Usually it's the opposite. Usually you have Sorrell Corral, and then somebody else comes in. But that's
Corral,
a pretty
Corral is about as good a last-minute replacement you can get for a young prospect.
Yeah, that is a well-traveled and well-experienced journeyman, if you will.
And he's not a beat man yet. He's trying to set traps. I think most of his success has come when he's able to put Williams against the ropes. That's not happening right now, but he's still here to win this fight.
Yeah, absolutely.
Another round comes to an end. Williams and Corral. That was the third frame of a scheduled 8-rounder. So, Chris, we're going to again say welcome back to Massachusetts.
Thank you. It is good to be back. It's nice to see Boston Boxing in its original home of Massachusetts. Normally, the majority of their work in the past few years has been in New Hampshire. So it's nice to see them return to Massachusetts and a lot of excitement locally around that.
And, of course, we're in beautiful Melrose, Massachusetts. We are, as I was telling Sean and Kyle, 10 minutes from Dom's Sausage Company, home of the world's best steak tips. with 10 minutes from the legends, Kelly's Roast Beef.
Oh, wow.
And
I've
the Kowloon.
Kelly's Roast Beef. I got to try these steak tips you're talking about. I only live 25 minutes up the road.
Oh, they're right in an industrial park in Malden. Dom Sausage Company.
The Mad Dog is always a huge proponent Absolutely. Of Dom Sausage.
Kowloon is going to be the place to be after the show. All I'm saying. Okay. World's best Chinese food. Yeah.
Who could forget Mick Foley getting his cheap pops by mentioning Calhoun every time that the WWE was in Boston?
Of course.
Yeah. The Monday Night Wars. And tonight we have a Saturday Night War with Williams and Corral heading into our fourth round.
I will say this. What the North Shore does right, already being a self-proclaimed South Shore guy, the North Shore has better roast beef sandwiches. The South Shore has better pizza. Feel free to hit me up on Twitter and debate the facts.
I'm going to take your word for that as a North Shore guy. I'll take that as a fair trade-off.
Well, someone who's raised in New Jersey, you guys can have your pizza. So, very meat-oriented up here.
I didn't know that. Raised in New Jersey?
Yeah, born and raised. Ooh, Mike Williams with a beautiful two right down the middle. It definitely got Corral's attention. And that hand speed is really starting to show up in this round.
Nice feint there by Mike Vaughn.
A lot of times what separates fighters is the movement that's occurring in between the punches. And Mike Vaughn has great side to side. The shoulders are moving. He's constantly making it difficult for Corral to find his spot.
Very astute observation there, Chris. I agree.
Williams coming off of a fifth round victory over Tyrone Lucky at the Connecticut Convention Center in Hartford.
And as we touched on, really nice turnout from Williams tonight. His fans are definitely in the house. They made the drive. And that's what's great about the New England boxing scene. It's so supportive that even when you're from a different state, fans will gladly cross the border to support their guy. Corral's starting to tie up a little bit. I think he's understanding that when Williams gets close, he can use those really quick, fast shots, so he kind of needs to stop the action like so.
I'm just kind of waiting, though, to see Williams start to go to the body. He is jabbing it, but outside the jab to the body, he could be doing more body work, I feel. I'd say that's the only thing I think he could be doing better right now is.
And there it is.
Accuracy is beautiful, and right as for speak of the devil.
Yeah,
right
he throws. And he's got fast enough hands where he can.
And there's another nice two body shots. That was a right and a left.
He can get to both sides. A lot of guys in that split second when the body opens up, they can only get one in.
Side,
but when you get those fast hands, pop, pop, you can rock both sides. And he just did that twice in a row, which is very effective.
Right now, Chris, you're absolutely right. Most guys, they can only get that one shot, and he's able to get both, as you just showed us. And there are some more he missed, but he's now got the right idea to start finding that body. I think in order for Williams to score a knockout, he'll have to land those body shots and test the body touch.
Yeah.
And if he gets, what is it, six or eight rounds?
Oh, this is an eight-rounder. Yeah.
If he gets
and
eight rounds in, I'm sure Paul will be happy with that as well.
Oh, yeah, it's great eight rounds of work. But for fans sometimes, you know, the bloodthirst sets in. They're not so much concerned about getting those rounds of work. They want to see a prospect. I take out a guy like this, you know, and a stoppage would be a feather in his cap because, again, the high-level guys stop Sal Corral. The guys that may not make it to the top tend to go the distance. And there's always exceptions based on styles, but if you look at the history of the guys that have stopped him. He looks great, though. Incredibly sharp. Looks like he's having fun in the corner.
Does appear to be having fun. Very relaxed.
Clearly has a great gas tank, doesn't seem to be breathing hard.
We headed for round five of eight here between Williams and Corral.
It goes to show you, though, guys, you know you're watching a fun prospect and a real veteran. Those five rounds have gone by fast.
Yeah.
I didn't realize it was the fifth round.
There's just a composure that you see with guys like Williams that are clearly headed to that next level. There's just something about a comfort in that ring. And it dates back to all the experience that he has in the amateurs, being a national champion like you had mentioned, Sean.
I was just going to say, Chris, there's always an exception to the rule where you'll see a guy like this that doesn't have that that extensive amateur background. Mm-hmm. There are naturals in all aspects of sports and life, but for the most part, you see somebody with this type of composure, yeah. you can bet on them having an extensive amateur background.
Tons of rounds, and it makes such a difference, you know, and I think we've seen that already in some fights tonight. Even some very talented fighters, like Danny Robles, who obviously I work with and a huge fan of, you know, he's learning on the job. He does yes. with virtually, essentially no amateur experience. That's a tough hurdle when you get in there with yeah. guys, and that was a beautiful counter from Sal Corral that actually caught Williams.
Yeah, and while we were talking before that, he landed a right hand. I think Mike Wong cut his foot on the slippery part of the canvas, and he mentioned something, but he snuck in a right hand as well. And now Leo
Leo is
he's getting the outside of that, and he should be doing the middle as well. There we go, Leo. Taking good care of that.
The Gerstel shuffle going on in the middle of the ring.
So funny that breaks that occur like that. I mean, obviously unexpected, but a smart fighter knows how to take advantage of that.
Absolutely.
That's where you bring the big, deep breaths back. That's where you relax
a little.
Through
the nose, out through the mouth. Yep.
That's time to get some extra wind.
Like to see Williams get back to that beautiful jab he has. He's kind of gotten away from it a little as he's walking his man down.
Yeah.
The minute he starts, nice right uppercut counter, but in the left hand.
Fast
counter.
Hands, yeah. Oh,
big shot by Williams.
There he tried to touch the body. Again, touches the body with the left hook. He keeps having issues with that. They got to do a better job of drying that off.
He's having
a rolling ankle.
Yeah, every time he goes to the body, he's having a lot of success, but he kind of seems to be headhunting a little bit tonight.
Nice, quick trigger on that left hook. I agree. A little bit ever so slightly.
See, that was beautiful. That real fast jab to the body and sneaking in that six uppercut in the back.
Both guys trying to really avoid standing in the middle of that emblem at the center of the ring.
Yeah, actually, you're right, Mad Dog. It seems like they're actually trying to work around it. I think some of that's Leo. He seems to be holding the emblem down.
Both of these guys are real professional fighters. You'd hate to see an injury because of something like slipping on a ring.
That beautiful body work there, Sean. I'm
telling you, if he gets to that body attack, I think that's his best bet to get a stoppage. If not... Oof. And left hook to the body finish there.
I mean, he's got the he just threw a 1-2 to the body. You don't see that a lot. You see the one, you see the
no,
two, but you
certainly
you
do not
see a
1-2 to the body all that often. Mm-hmm. You're right. See how he's starting to find a home for that left hook to the body, guys?
Yeah, and Corral's a veteran, though, huh? He sure is. He grabs that power hand, wraps it up.
Corral's left eye starting to swell up a little bit. A small bit of blood there. We'll see how that comes into play. Williams entering the sixth round, still has every last mile per hour behind his jab.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. He hasn't slowed down in any way, shape, or form. I think he's going to be really happy with the performance if it stays at this pace.
Yeah.
Some things to work on, but man, you get those good rounds against guys like this, it's priceless.
Exactly right. Yeah.
Sometimes the guys that are blasting guys like this in 1, 2, 3 rounds, they're not getting those necessary rounds, and then they get to that level where their guy takes them deep like that, and they have trouble, whether it's a gas tank or just being as fast as they usually are, you know. Saying that right now, I believe, with Edgar Berlanga. When he went on that crazy knockout streak and turned everybody on, when he went to that next level, you know, he's done like what now?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and now we're seeing a side of him that, you know, maybe he's not as impressive as we thought because he's having trouble working in the later rounds.
You can't substitute rounds.
Yeah.
And Williams is getting some here, and this is great.
Yeah.
Against a real veteran, too. Yeah.
In a sense, sometimes, you know, you as a trainer, I'm sure, Sean, is like, if somebody says, I can get him out in a round, or we can do 6. Obviously, if you can get him, you get him. But if it's a situation where it ends up being a 6-round fight, you're simply going to learn more.
I always say in hindsight, you know, if we see the opportunity for a knockout, take it. But there's been times where that's what I was looking for, and it ends up going the distance. And
you learn from that.
And I'm happy with it. I'm happy that the fight went the distance. Yeah. even Brandon Higgins' last fight with Dustin.
Yeah, which will be our rematch tonight in the main event.
Part of us wanted to stop him, but at the same time after, I thought that was a perfect fight for Brandon to learn, regroup from the loss to Harry and learn and kind of nice jab, I won. But, you know, I think what Brandon Beautiful. Learned in that fight that night is gonna help him and serve him throughout his career.
Yeah, absolutely. And Williams continuing to – he's really starting to find that body now and use that speed.
I figured it was only a matter of time. I'd just like to see him get back to his jab and set his body work up off his jab. And I think regardless if it's a decision win or a stoppage, he's going to look
It's a dominant performance regardless.
But I think the opportunity looks sensational if he just keeps that jab in his opponent's face and goes up and down and sets that body work up, because now you guys are seeing – how well-rounded he is. Not only is he a sharpshooter to the head, he has a very accurate sharp puncher to the body. And I just love the way he bends at the waist.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good. His version of a slip is actually he's short enough to just duck under the shot.
Kind of reminds me a little of Meldrick Taylor, the way back in the day when Meldrick Taylor would fight, the way he'd move at the waist and make guys miss right at the waist.
Yeah. I mean, that's a gorgeous combination when you can look at that. Three shots every time. And that's another thing that's tough to teach guys when they're coming up, is when you have that moment, you got to let three or four shots go off. You know, you're going to hurt the guy with the shot. It's not going to be the first one. Probably won't even be the second one. It's that third or fourth, you know.
Nice quick jab.
Williams is just 24 right years old.
That's another scary thing is how young he is. He's just somebody that's been a pro for 7 years. He turned pro at 17.
Well, that's a fascinating fact.
Yeah, I believe DiBella did sort of like a pep rally at his high school. He was still in high school when he signed pro.
Insane.
12 amateur bouts, an amateur record of 6 wins, 6 losses.
But that is the amateur records according to BoxRec. Williams,
that's what they have him at?
No.
That's what BoxRec has.
He's a five-time national champ. I'd say he's got probably close to 80 amateur fights.
Yeah, absolutely.
Actually, I think I saw it somewhere. I think it's around 50. Yeah. But again, 5 national amateur titles.
Yeah, he's got a lot of amateur fights. And it shows.
He's
not even quick to sit down on the stool. You know what I mean? He's in an 8-round fight. Most guys are trying to find that stool as quick as they can.
And I don't know how you guys feel, but he's looked impressive all night, but I felt that was probably his best round.
Yeah.
He had the body attack going, the jab going.
He's starting to take control. Well, he's been in control the whole time, to be fair, but he's starting to overwhelm him a little bit.
Williams, the number 25 ranked in the nation, number 91 worldwide.
And only 24 years old.
Only 24 years old. That delayed looking for the stool, that's the 24-year-old.
Yeah.
As an elder statesman here, I am 29 years old.
You're looking for the stool.
I am looking for the stool the second I hear that bell.
Looking for the stool, the Mike Mad Dog story, coming to Lifetime this fall.
That's going to be the name of my memoir, Looking for the Stool.
I think it's very obvious to say that Williams has probably won every round handedly. If Corral wants to win this fight, he's looking to land something really special.
Yeah, and it's okay that he's going backwards. Sometimes you got a better chance of walking somebody into something like that, but he's got to start to take a little bit more chances. Yeah. But that's always easier said than done when you're dealing with somebody with brilliant hand speed like Williams.
100%.
Just love the way Williams changes heights.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he'll attack you bending at those knees, and he'll attack you down to the body.
And for the most part, right in the pocket, right there in punching range, where if he makes you miss, he can make you pay.
Yeah, and body shots, I mean, you know, one of the basic things I'm sure you teach kids in the gym when they're starting is you have to change your level a little bit. You can't punch down. It's that little quickie squat as you
take
the shot.
Got to take your defense with you to throw the body shots. Yes,
exactly,
sir.
And he's got that down to a science. I mean, very, very skilled fighter.
He missed that left hook to the body, but you guys can see how he gets really good leverage and how quick it is. Yeah, he's doing a nice little feint off to his left side, I think, in hopes of getting that left hook to the body uncooked. Would like to just see him get back to his jab, and right as I say it, he does it.
Does give up.
Oh, nice short right hand.
4 inches of reach to
Corral. That's the best
punch
of the round. Yeah. And I'd say at least 4 inches in height. Snuck that left hook into the body.
Yeah. And the one thing that's helping, again, as we talked about, is he's getting good rounds. I mean, he's got a, I think he's a 500% KO ratio. So a guy like that is getting a lot of rounds.
A lot of rounds,
yep. So he takes that jump where everybody's doing the rounds. He's going to be ready for it instead of a power puncher that, you know, has, he's 17-0 like Williams, but, you know, 14 of the fights are by knockout. You
right.
know? He's getting real honest experience here that I think is going to serve him very well in the future. Oh, gorgeous lead hook.
Kind of smothered himself there. I would have liked to see him go back to a jab after he landed that big shot, just give himself a little distance.
Yeah.
He's dialing in, though. He's looking for some mean stuff right now.
Yeah. You know, he's probably really close to having that step-up fight against another prospect. If well, not he, in his next fight, you
he
know.
He does have a win on Showbox against an undefeated prospect, and it was a fun fight to watch, a fight that he was relatively dominant in, but it was like a puzzle he had to solve,
uh-huh.
and he solved it.
Yeah.
See the way Williams makes you miss right in the pocket, though, with that head movement? You mentioned it earlier with the jab, the way he just slips it right on the inside.
Just the comfort level is so impressive, you know.
But, yeah, I think you're right, Chris. He's got that step-up win on Showbox.
I'm ready to see another one, though.
I think that's coming right around the corner.
It's time. I mean, when you can fight a guy like Corral and essentially dominate every single round, you know, you're ready for that next step. Very impressive performance so far, no doubt. Yet at the same time, not necessarily a crowd-enticing kind of performance either.
Right.
Now, his people are here, and they love that, but that could be something as the ball rolls when you sort of need to start creating that big fan base. I could see his style, as sweet and beautiful it is to people that understand boxing, I could see casual fans maybe not getting behind it because you can see a lot of decisions in his future.
Yeah, and it is the fighter's responsibility, you know, to keep winning, but also make people want to see you again. You know, boxing purists like us love to watch this type of style. But, you know, to be that next level attraction, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And that is a part of it that gets forgotten a lot, you know. Unless your talent is so shockingly superior that people will watch it that don't even understand. The Floyd Mayweathers of the world, you know.
You got to be very good to make that work.
You have to be you have to be a very special talent to make that style of fighting work, you know.
But I must have seen Williams now in person from the amateurs till now maybe 15 times, and every time I see him, he impresses me.
And that's what makes great fighters is they grow. They're better every time you see them. They learn, and that's one of the key things.
Beautiful jab. I think it's important to give Corral credit for using his caginess and experience. He's done a good job tying Williams up tonight.
Yeah.
Whenever Williams gets any momentum, he'll kind of tie him up. You'll see Williams being smart, not really wasting any energy in the clinch, and just kind of waiting to be broken to get back to doing what he's doing.
But again, Corral, you know, occasionally comes forward and lets a combination off, and
when he does, that's when his only real successful offensive moments come.
Yeah, he just needs to be busier, frankly. You know, but he's so worried about that speed that, you know.
I was just going to say, Chris, I think it's Williams' speed that's keeping him on his back foot. You've seen him before. I haven't seen him, so I'm assuming he normally comes forward. But I think that speed is kind of putting him on his back foot.
Yeah, he's absolutely more of a scrappier guy than we're seeing tonight.
See the way he wrapped Williams up, though, there? Yeah. This is that valuable experience.
The double wing
that,
hold.
That you were talking about that you're going to learn from these types of fights here. To fight the guys he's fought, he has to know pretty much all the tricks in the book.
Yeah, a good veteran fighter is just simply not going to let you beat the hell out of him. That's the whole point.
Right. Yeah, he could fight somebody again in 2 weeks the way tonight's gone. And he's in there with the stud.
Well, and
so that's saying a lot.
You know, I mean, we're obviously super high on Williams for obvious reasons, but it's a testament to Corral as well that this is a guy that could have come here and taken an easy payday, but he's still trying to win this fight, and he's going to go the distance with an undefeated prospect, and he's going to find himself in another fight against an undefeated prospect.
It's two real professional fighters.
Yeah.
One is in the prospect position, and the other is in the opponent. But they make no mistake about it. These are guys that fight for a living.
Yeah, exactly.
I love that left hand of the body when he uses it.
And what's nice about Sal Corral is he's still going the distance. It's not a guy that's like, oh, the end of the ride. Here come the streak of KO losses, you know. It's actually a very well matched fight.
You can tell he still takes a lot of pride in what he does.
Yeah. I imagine Jackie Callen is really happy getting an opponent like this, especially on last-minute notice, to watch a guy get some rounds against a real seasoned journeyman. You know?
Absolutely. Nice left uppercut. And that came from that little drop he does to the left, that little dip. And let's give Williams credit here, winning the fight, but is looking for that sensational finish.
Yeah, he's still bringing it. He could be coasting right now, but he's still coming forward and throwing. What a balance. Fast hands, man. Whew.
And he puts his jab at the end of it. Oh, nice right hand to the body. Maybe the best body shot of the night.
I think that may have affected him in a second.
Well, we will head.
And there you have it.
To the judges' scorecards.
Impressive performance from Williams all around.
Should be a pretty handy decision in favor of Myquan Williams.
I would be utterly shocked if it's not a shutout on all three judges' cards.
Yeah, I'd be absolutely astonished if Williams didn't win all eight rounds.
Once again, it's nice to see Williams' manager, Jackie Callen, the world-famous Jackie Callen, portrayed by Meg Ryan in a biopic about her career and her time working with James Tony.
We've got Corral and Williams just waiting on the official announcement for the victor of our fifth bout of the evening.
And we have three more to go for everybody watching at home.
All welterweights.
Yeah, three.
Only one
contest.
Four-rounder and a couple of big names in the co-main and the main event.
The Massachusetts debut of Nicholas Tejada, which is super exciting. Kenny Larson, Ryan Clark, that could easily be fight of the night, without a doubt. That is a 50-50, well-matched, exciting fight. Larson's toughest test. Clark always is capable of pulling off an upset. And then the long-awaited rematch of Higgins, Dustin Reinhold in the main event. I think everybody's excited to see how that plays out. I know Higgins is absolutely looking to stop Reinhold this time, to leave no doubt. And Reinhold feels that he didn't get a fair shake on the scorecards, and he's looking to put on a performance tonight to even out the potential trilogy. But three really exciting fights coming up.
I felt the first time, you know, I might have been a little biased. I was in Brandon's corner, but I thought Brandon
I would say that's the height of bias, by the way.
But you know, I'm the same person that admitted that I felt Harry, you know, did a little more in that fight. I felt Brandon won the last fight 4-2, but Dustin has a problem with it. Credit to Brandon for taking
getting a
win and taking the tough fight.
Yeah, I happen to agree with you. I thought it was 4-2 as well for Higgins. I think ultimately the judges got it right. But, you know, there's always controversy when a fight goes the distance that another guy wins around.
Yeah.